Being an adult cardiac surgeon, I have chosen few topics which seem to be very important for cardiac surgeon, as well as things are happening in these fields. The topics being coronary artery bypass grafting, heart valve replacement, mitral valve replacement or repair, aortic valve replacement, transcatheter aortic valve replacement, popularly known as TAVR, heart failure treatment, mechanical circulatory support, and finally, heart transplant. I started in Hyderabad in 1985. People say B-Salbad is very good, but I have completed T-Sal, 30 years. With those days, Dr. Somraju, Dr. Rajagopal Raju used to be chiefs. Dr. K.V. Naidu used to be the other chief on the cardiac surgical side. And we used to think and then think about various things that can happen. And coronary bypass surgery was in our minds. First thing in our mind was coronary bypass surgery. Then, when we looked at the past, maybe past could be up to 85, it was done under cardiopulmonary bypass, with or without cardioplegia, most of the times with cardioplegia, and anastomosis of the coronary arteries were done on the hearts, which were stopped either by cardioplegia or without cardioplegia. The cardiopulmonary bypass system was one of the most important things in that whole system. There used to be a big team of cardiac surgeons, perfusionists, and at that time and subsequently, the left internal mammary artery grafting was proven to be the most important part in the coronary artery bypass surgery, which is still true today. Then what is happening now? Since that time when we started coronary bypass surgery with cardiopulmonary bypass, especially in India, we progressed towards off-pump coronary bypass surgery. However, since my literature review and talking to the few surgeons in United States, this is not true for the United States surgery. United States surgery, still it is about 20% is off-pump and 80% is on-pump. But in India, I think most of the operations, especially in private institutions, are in off-pump surgery. One of the American surgeons asked me, why can't you do it under cardiopulmonary bypass, why it is so easy to do it? Then we looked at the, like Dr. Sridhar said, we looked at the finances. If the total coronary bypass surgery is 1,10,000 to 1,00,000, if we add cardiopulmonary bypass system to it, it takes about 20,000, or maybe about 17,000 to 20,000. It comes to 1/5 of the total cost of the patient, cost to the patient. So this also could be one of the reasons why we are doing more and more off-pump. The Indian surgeons are supposed to be more dexterous. So they are in a state where almost all the coronary bypass operations are done are off-pump surgery. This is the reality today, which may not be the international trend. There are some situations where the off-pump coronary bypass surgery is forced on us, especially in patients where there is aneurysm or the disease of the ascending aorta, where we cannot cross clamp. There is a previous cerebrovascular disease event and carotid artery disease. Some of these things, we don't want to touch the aorta. So we tend to get into this no-touch technique for the aorta. Also, the other trend that has taken up in the last few years is importance for the multiple arterial grafts, whether it is bilateral internal mammary artery, whether it's a radial artery, and almost this the stomach arteries and other things, there are not many people are doing. So this is what is happening now in the coronary artery bypass grafting. Then the next thing, what is the future? Now the more and more common people are talking about robotic surgery, minimal invasive surgery. But in my personal opinion, even though I do less, very rarely minimal invasive coronary bypass grafting, coronary bypass grafting is a very skilled and accurate procedure. Any small event, small stitch can kill the patient. It is unlike other operations where the death is because of the small technical problem. So, however, there are some centers where robotic surgery has become quite common, but it has not taken off. And when we looked at the cost involved for these procedures, they are quite costly. Robotic surgery is quite expensive. Even in the United States, they are charging almost a 70 to 80 lakh rupees for doing this robotic coronary artery bypass surgery. Then another thing that happened in coronary bypass surgery, you know, that is what is happening, is there are a lot of developments in the anesthesia, perioperative management, critical care management, anesthesia drugs. There are so many things in anesthesia which has taken the coronary artery bypass surgery into a short procedure. Nowadays, it is very rare for us to keep the patient beyond 1 week in cardiac surgical units after coronary bypass surgery. And at the end of 1 month, they are almost always referred back to the cardiologist. We have occasional problems, one or two patients in a 100, but very rarely they stay in the cardiac surgical units for more than one week. Then some of the major advances that are taking place in cardiac surgery is they are taking place in the heart valve therapy. Heart valve therapy for a replacement or repair. Traditionally, let us look at the mitral valve. It was always done by mid-sternotomy under cardiopulmonary bypass. Cardiopulmonary bypass still the common. But mitral valve replacement, especially in our country, where the rheumatic heart disease is more common, by a St. Jude valve or some other mechanical valve. And then gradually, we progress towards the heart valve repairs. Dr. Pat Beringer talked about this topic, mitral valve repairs. This is something which is catching up even in India, even though majority of the operations today, even today, is mitral valve replacements, that to mechanical valves, where in our country, the follow-up is limited. And because of that limited follow-up, the mortality rates are very well known. The anticoagulation problems are quite common. So another thing that happened was the advanced imaging system, especially the transesophageal echocardiography, three-dimensional echocardiography, which has revolutionized the treatment for mitral valve repair and aortic valve repair. And in centers where there is several cardiologists, some of them specialize in the advanced imaging techniques, especially the echocardiogram. There are many images, but in the echocardiogram, if we have a good 3D echocardiogram, 2D echocardiogram, it is almost always certain that we can repair a valve which is suitable for repair. Hence, the need for the cardiologist, need for the preoperative echocardiogram, need for the intraoperative echocardiogram. In United States, it is a standard clinical practice to have the intraoperative transesophageal echocardiogram on all cardiac surgical patients, either it is coronary or valve. And I have seen one of the cardiologists always comes to the operating room before and after the operation to evaluate the repair or to predict the type of repair, evaluate repair, give an opinion. They may be doing it for medical legal purposes, but it is a scientific advance. I don't think we are doing it that commonly, but that is something which we need to do. Mitral valve repairs. In patients where there is rheumatic, so many repairs can be done. In patients with non-rheumatic heart disease, especially in the European population, where there is prolapse of the leaflets, mitral regurgitation, it is almost certain. Nowadays, they are predicting nearly 100%. It may not be true, but almost predicting the mitral valve repairs with ring, not without ring. Then, we had one patient, for example, as I told, we are getting into more and more patients with mitral valve repairs. Preoperative echocardiograms and postoperative echocardiograms is the mainstay in the evaluation of the patients with mitral valve disease for surgical evaluation. As surgeons, it is very common for us and it is very necessary for us to see these patients in the echocardiogram room in consultation with the cardiologist. And I would suggest to the cardiologist to call your surgeons and show them, this is exactly what we are doing. This is how the repair has to take place. This is something which is coming more and more frequent. And with the advent of 3D echocardiograms, it is certain that they have to be working together, associated together. Then the next thing that happened was minimally invasive mitral wall repair or replacement. When you call it minimally invasive, it could be a minimally invasive by a robotic system, minimally invasive by the surgeon direct view. It usually through a right thoracotomy, a small incision. However, it is still cardiopulmonary bypass. Except the incision, the impact and the surgical trauma coming out of the cardiopulmonary bypass has not been reduced. And also, this also requires certain learning curve. And with that learning curve, it is in advanced countries where they can afford, they are doing robotic mitral repair. Some of the surgeons in India, including ourselves, we are doing occasional mitral valve repairs by minimal invasive, by direct visualization. It definitely gives some perioperative, postoperative advantage for the patients, and it is definitely friendly to the patient. But however, that also requires a lot of expenditure in the form of cannulas, in the form of advanced anesthesia, double lumen endotracheal tubes, surgery can be done. And I have seen in the advanced countries, whenever the minimally invasive surgery is done, they are always doing into the hybrid operating rooms, where they are doing the coronary sinus cannulation through the hybrid operating rooms, transesophageal echocardiogram, intra-aortic aorta cannulation, cross clamp through the endoscopy system. So these are some of the things that is coming up. I don't think that they will completely replace the conventional surgery, but in countries where they can afford and where there is a lot of expertise and then commercially viable, they are doing these procedures. Then, Dr. Dayasagar have already mentioned about the TAVR. Aortic wall replacement is a standard operating procedure where the surgeons do a mid sternotomy under cardiopulmonary bypass. Aortic valve is replaced either with a mechanical valve or a biological valve, depending on the indication. However, in some of the countries, and also in India, it is gradually becoming more and more common to use the transcatheter aortic wall replacement, either transcatheter. The catheter can be through the groin, the catheter can be either from the apex where the surgical help is taken, or either from the aorta. Through the catheter, they introduce and do the TAVR. The American Society has not given this as a procedure for all the patients with low-risk aortic wall replacement. However, for patients with high-risk cardiopulmonary bypass, elderly age, where it is considered based on the STS score and other things, that these patients may not survive a heart valve procedure, heart valve replacement, they are going for TAVR. In some of the countries, it is gradually increasing more and more, 20, 30, and 30, 35. I don't think immediately it is going to be that common in India, because so many, at least more than 50% of our aortic wall replacements are rheumatic heart disease patients in younger population, where the risk of surgery is not that much. Elderly people also, when we see, we don't see that type of high-risk aortic wall replacement disease. However, being a huge country with a lot of population, there is always a scope for this type of procedure, and I hope it will become a common procedure soon in our country. That will increase our evaluation of the patients and surgical profile as well. So is there a future for TAVR? There is a future. However, it is quite expensive in India. That also could be one of the reasons why we are not doing that many TAVR procedures. Another procedure that is becoming more and more common, in patients with annulo aortic ectasia, where there is dilatation of the aortic root and the aortic leaflets are normal. Previously, we were doing this aortic wall replacement, that is what we call as Bentall operation, and then replace the aortic wall, replace the aorta. However, there is one, Dr. Tyrone David, who visualized about the preserving the aortic wall, which was normal. So he replaced the aortic root, replaced the coronary arteries, reattached them, put a ascending aorta graft, and these grafts worked well. So these are some of the things which is becoming more and more common in cardiac surgery. The most important advance in the cardiac surgery in the last decade has taken place in the heart failure treatment. In early 2000s, there was a book published by James Kirkland, who is son of John Kirkland, on cardiac transplantation. We were in the process of doing some cardiac transplantations. And then I looked at that book. In 2003, that book was published. The heart devices, left ventricular assist devices, were considered as emerging technologies, even though they were considered to be, by that time, they were already existing. The research was not complete. The clinical indications were complete. However, in the United States and Germany, a tendency has come in for the heart valve therapy. After the medical therapy, when there is end stage heart failure, we can still do some surgeries, like whenever there is a ischemic myocardium, still some residual ischemia, coronary bypass, valve repair, if the valve repair is responsible, repair or replacement, if that is responsible for the coronary artery, responsible for the heart failure, and left ventricular aneurysm repair, if that is responsible for the heart disease. Some of these things can be done by the surgeons. In association with the cardiologist, electrophysiology management, which is also part of the talk, electrophysiology management, controlling arrhythmias, and then pacemaker insertion, some of these things could be part of the management. These are all evolved over a period of time. However, in the last decade, more and more people, more and more advanced units are going towards mechanical circulatory support, that is artificial heart or the left ventricular assist device. Left ventricular assist devices are becoming more and more common. They have not become common in India, but a stage will come when there is no other treatment of medicine, no other treatment of electrophysiology, no other treatment of conventional surgery like coronary artery bypass surgery, grafting, and other things. We may have to go for this heart failure treatment, that is mechanical circulatory support, MCS. And then MCS, mechanical circulatory support, is also very important for short-term therapy, as a short-term therapy, for the people doing advanced interventional cardiology. For example, somebody who is doing a complex percutaneous interventions, patient crash, coronary bypass surgery probably is ruled out even before the PCI. So these patients go for temporary support, and then they get back to normal again. And then long-term support, that is another subject altogether. These are some of the things which, as a senior cardiologist, I would advise you to look into it, but the cost is prohibitive. When we are thinking and talking about the advances, medical advances, we also should talk about the cost, and we also talk about the benefit. At the moment, in the Indian population, the discussion is going on whether spending a crore of rupees on a particular device where the results are not according to the established norm, whether it's all right or not. This is something which we need to look at. I will close at it. And then the transplantation. What is it? Transplantation numbers are not progressing. However, the results of the cardiac transplantation are very good. The first year survival is about nearing 90%. 89, 88%. 3 year survival is 75 plus, 5 year survival is nearing 70. However, in all the countries, still the heart transplantation is not progressing, probably because there is the availability of the donors is less, and with the present squeeze on the cardiac surgical procedures and cardiac medical procedures by these some of the insurance-related problems, we probably not able to progress beyond certain point, even though there is a need to increase the type of cardiac transplantation, the heart transplantation in our patients. However, the medical therapy has progressed. There are several new drugs. Still, there is a refractory end-stage heart failure which would require heart transplantation. Maybe the heart devices like left ventricular devices as a bridge to transplant or a destination therapy or a temporary device is possible. But at some stage, all these people will get benefited out of heart transplantation. It is also useful for intractable ventricular arrhythmias, some subsets. It is also useful in some congenital heart disease patients where there is no other medical therapy. However, I would also like to say that the rejection is not completely understood and then completely, we have not managed it completely. Immunosuppression has still got its problems. There is a graft-related vascular disease still there, and the infections are also not controlled. And hopefully in future, the advanced heart failure, where both cardiologists and cardiac surgeons will end up in patients with more and more advanced therapy, we are going to have more of these patients with heart failure. These therapies, starting with the cardiologists and then going towards heart transplantation, devices, either destination, probably the future for cardiac surgery. With this, I would like to conclude my talk with this saying, cardiology and cardiac surgery is no more different specialties. We work as a team. I have seen and I worked as a team with several cardiologists, very brilliant group of cardiologists. They diagnose, they manage the patients, they educate the patient, they communicate to the patient and give to us, we operate and give them back. A stage has come where the heart teams has concept as a combined management of these patients, which is gradually becoming more and more reality. I thank the organization for giving me the opportunity. Thank you very much.